Hopeless Church is dismissed, amen, to go with Sister Candy upstairs in the children's church room. Praise God. Ephesians chapter 2 in the Word of God, verses 8 through 10. And before I even read that scripture, I want to ask you all a question. What are you doing concerning your abilities, talents, and what God has blessed you with in order to advance the kingdom of God? How many of you know that every one of us have a responsibility as Christians? How many know we're saved to serve? Every one of you in these pews and watching by live streaming and also community television later on in the week have gifts and abilities that God has blessed you with. He didn't bless you with those things just for you, but how many know he blessed you with those things to serve others with? So all of us are servants of the Lord, isn't that correct? Now don't feel bad this morning if you feel like, you know, Pastor Craig, I've been saved for a while and I haven't done anything for the Lord. I hope that this message will really, really encourage you and cultivate, for you to cultivate the things that God has blessed you with and how you can incorporate those gifts and abilities into the kingdom of God to advance his kingdom. Amen? How many know our gifts are not all the same? Amen. I mean, if you put me on the drum set up here, I clear out the church within 2 minutes because I don't know how to play the drums. But you ask me to preach, teach the word of God, and do counseling, and those where my giftings lie. And so every one of our gifts we have to use with excellence to the Lord. Amen. Not a casual every now and then when we feel like it. How many know we're working for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Amen. And I want to point you all to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10, and I'm reading the New Living Translation Bible today. The Bible tells us, Ephesians 2, 8 through 10, the Bible tells us God saved you by his special favor when you believed, and you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. Verse 10 says, and I'm focusing on that this morning, for we are God's masterpiece. Now somebody look at your neighbor and say, I'm God's masterpiece. Amen. How many know God doesn't make junk? That's what the New Living Translation, that's how that puts it. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus. Why? So that we can do the things he planned for us long ago. Notice what it says. So we can what? Do the things that he, God, planned for us long ago. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. I pray that every one of us would be used in your kingdom, Lord, for the gifts and talents and abilities that you have blessed us with. Father, I pray that we would search our hearts, Lord, and ask ourselves this morning some very basic, simple questions. What am I good at? What are my passions for? Who do I like to hang out with? What do I like to do in life? What can I do to advance your kingdom? And Father, we just pray in the name of Jesus, that you just have your perfect way and will with every one of us. And we thank you for that, Father God. I decrease right now from behind this pulpit. Holy Spirit, increase within me, Lord God. And Lord, we pray that you'd share the word you've placed on my heart to everybody today. We thank you and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. Praise the Lord. So what gifts, talents, and abilities do you have in advancing God's kingdom? As I was praying this past week, I was asking the Lord, Lord, what do you want me to bring forth? What do you want me to bring forth for us today? And the Lord kind of moved on my heart with the scripture that he says, you know, the laborers are few. Amen. How many know there are very few laborers in the body of Christ? But the harvest is plenteous. You know, we live in a place called New England. We understand New England's kind of cold spiritually and so forth, and there's a lot of rocky soil spiritually in New England. But how many know that's not to stop us from sharing God's word with people? We want to see people in heaven. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now, you were born on purpose for a purpose. I want you to think about those words. You were born on purpose. God wants you here. Somebody say, God wants me here. I'll tell you a little testimony about my own life. And, you know, my mother and father, you know, they had I have two older brothers and one older sister. And what had happened was my parents, you know, they wanted children, of course, and so forth. And they had my brother Reed, okay, and then they wanted to have a girl. And so they were hoping to have a girl. And, of course, my brother Wayne, he's the next one born. Wayne's not a girl, by the way. Hope he's not watching. I'll get an email. Glory to God. Anyway, but anyway, then finally my sister Diane, number three. So my mom's name is Jean, and my dad's name was George, and so forth. And then, you know, they said, okay, well, we're all done having kids. Praise God. So then one day, when my mom was 41 years old, had some announcement to make to George. George, I need to talk to you about something. What's going on? Is a bill not paid? What's happening? We're going to have another baby. He said, how could this happen? George, you know how that happened. And here comes Craig down the pipe. Glory to God. Amen. So I was child number four, and they finally stopped having kids at that point in time. Now I can think to myself in the natural, and I was a mistake. God, you know, mom and dad didn't plan on having me. It just happened. But how many know that God wanted me here? And I'm not saying that to puff myself up by any way, shape, or form, but every single one of us who are humanly born are born on purpose for a purpose. Amen. And how many know we have a job to do? You know, I know we work, we have to pay our bills, we have to do our responsibilities. You know, we have to, go to the grocery store, bring up our children, they're going to school, and all these different responsibilities. Of course we need to do that. But let's not lose sight on what God called us to do for Him. Let's not lose sight. You know, sometimes a person one time said, well, Pastor Craig, I just work at a store. I'm not really good at doing anything. I said, you could take some very basic Bible tracts that we have for free out there, and you can plant those Bible tracts all over the place, provided that they're legally allowed wherever you plant them naturally. You don't go in people's mailboxes and throw them in there, because then I'll be getting some nasty messages on the phone upstairs. Amen. But how many know we can be used of the Lord in all different areas of our life? Amen. We were saved to serve. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10, in the New King James Version, it puts it this way. It says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. How many know our salvation is a gift from God? We can't work for our salvation. It's a gift of God. We have to receive the free gift of God. Now, after we receive the free gift of God, we accept Jesus Christ. We ask Jesus to come into our life to be our personal Lord and Savior and repent from our sins. How many know that there is an absolute change in words and behavior in our lives? If we're truly saved, there is a change. A person doesn't come up at the altar and say the words, you know, I accept Jesus and so forth, and then there's no change a year or two down the road. There has to be a change. That person's spirit has been born again, amen? How many of all of us are going to live forever? Yeah, our bodies are going to die. We're going to be buried 6 feet under and so forth. But our soul and our spirit are going to be alive for an eternity. And the Bible teaches that we're either going to go to heaven. The only way to get there is to know Jesus Christ now on this earth, have a personal relationship with Him, or we're going to spend an eternity in a horrible place called hell and pay for our own sins ourselves. Now, we know that Jesus Christ on the cross took all of our sins upon Him. He's the only one who didn't break God's law. All of us have fallen short of the glory of God. We've all broken God's high standard, amen, of living. So therefore, how many know we need a Savior? And His name is Jesus. So the Bible says, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Verse 10, for we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for what? For good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Now, what is that saying? The Bible teaches that God has created us before the foundation. God knew about us, rather, before the foundation of the world. How many know that's a long time ago? You and I were on God's mind before He even created the world. Now, you say, the little old me, God doesn't even think about me. Absolutely, He does. You know, the Bible tells us that God even is concerned about you when you lay your head down asleep at night. God is concerned with the decisions you make when you get up. And I could just picture Jesus having a conversation with our Heavenly Father. You know, that Agnes, you know, she's going to be born, and, you know, in a few thousand years, we're going to go ahead, and this is going to be her assignment. We're going to show her what it is. And we only can pray. The Bible says that Jesus is our intercessor. He's praying to God the Father for every one of us. So in those giftings that we have and abilities, how many know that we're going to be using those things for the kingdom of God? Amen? Somebody say glory to God. In the book of, I believe it's in 1 Corinthians, in the Word of God, the Apostle Paul tells us that we're going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ as Christians. And it's going to be not a judgment concerning whether we go to heaven or not. I'm talking about Christians will stand before Jesus, those who are born again. And we're going to have to give an account to everything we've done in our lives. And I hope that is a good report. Lord, I was used of you. You show me I have this gifting and this talent, and I use it to the excess concern, to the most excellent way, Lord, in order to fear you and to please you and to advance your kingdom. Amen? All of us have gifts, and they're all diverse gifts, all different types of things that we can do for the Lord. One thing that Satan comes and tells us, and he throws his fiery darts, and he says, yeah, you have that gift, but you can't use that for God. You're not that good with it. How many of you got to take a step of faith and say, you know, I'm going to use this gift for the Lord, whether I'm good or bad with it, in the name of Jesus. And I'm going to do it to the best of my ability, and I am going to go ahead, and I am going to, let's say you're a teacher. I'm going to teach like teaching has never been before taught. I am going to, you know, if whatever you are, if you're a pastor, be the best pastor you possibly can be. And how many know the Holy Spirit anoints you to do the things for God and to serve others to advance his kingdom? All you have to say is yes. Amen. Yes, send me, Lord. I'll go. Amen. We are saved by grace to first be someone that is a child of God, but we are equally empowered by that same grace to do something. You know, I love that. I love that little thing, that the little wedge that people sometimes have on their desks. It says, do it now. Even some t-shirts, do it now. You know, some people are professional procrastinators. How many of us are procrastinators? Raise your hand. Anybody procrastinating? Okay. Yeah. You say, hey, I got good plans. I like to do that. I know that's going to work out good, but you procrastinate. Don't do it. You know, I know that God wants me to do that one day, but, you know, right now, I don't think so. How many of God wants you to do that today? Amen. The one day will never happen unless you take a step of faith and move forward. Pastor, that's kind of risky if I do that. You know, God will back you up concerning risks that you take. If you do what is called of him, he is going to back you up. Amen. He'll back you up 100%. Praise be to God. So once again, remember, you were born on purpose for a purpose. Your life has great value in building the eternal. Now, how effective you are is not up to God, believe it or not, but it's up to you. Sometimes, you know, we as Christians, we're guilty sometimes. I think all of us sometimes we do this. We pray for something. All right, Lord, I want to see my loved ones saved. I want to see them saved. I want to see them come to the cross. I want them saved, Lord. I want to spend eternity in heaven with them. But the next question would be, are you sharing the word with them? Are you putting where the rubber meets the road and sharing God's word with them? It's okay to pray about something, but God through prayer gives us instruction. And maybe you say, yes, I have shared the word with my unsaved loved ones. I have done this and I have done that. Keep on persevering and never give up. In your prayers, pray, Lord, send other Christians into their lives so that the same message coming from someone else, they may receive the message altogether. But don't ever give up. Ever. How many of you know that even after you pass away, they can come to the cross? Because your prayers are still recognized by the Lord. Your prayers, the Bible says, are like sweet-smelling incense to the Lord. Amen? So keep on keeping on in the name of Jesus. What are we doing this morning to advance the kingdom of God individually? Romans chapter 12, verses 6 to 8, the Bible says, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith. Our ministry, let us see it in our ministering. He who teaches in teaching, he who exhorts in exhortation. What is exhorts? That's encouraging people, exhorting them. How many know we need more encouragers in the world today? There are way too many people that are pessimistic, and they'll barbecue you for anything you do that they think is wrong. Amen? We've got to be people that are positive, people that are to see the good in other people. Not just judge them and say, oh, look at that guy. Oh, I don't like the way he's dressed. He's probably this and he's probably that. That's a person that God's created, just like you and I. You know, we can't say, okay, Lord, I'm going to favor people that are rich and anybody that doesn't have any money. Nah, I'm going to just forget about them. How many know that we were all created in the image of God? Doesn't matter how much money we make. Doesn't make any difference what we look like. Amen. Praise the Lord. You know, we got to say, okay, Lord, have your perfect way and will. Let me be an encourager to people. Amen. He who gives with liberality, he who leads with diligence, he who shows mercy with cheerfulness. Amen. The Apostle Paul's pointing out that we have to really do everything in excellence for the Lord. Even in our work, whatever you do for a living, when you go to your job tomorrow, the Bible teaches that do all things as unto the Lord. That means that you do the best job you could do for that company. It doesn't matter if you think your boss is demon-possessed and he treats you really badly. Still do a good job as though Jesus was your boss. Amen. Because your example in doing a great job, even though your boss may be really mean to you, may lead that boss to Jesus Christ through your example. Amen. Amen? Praise the Lord. Don't sink to the level of people that are trying to pull you down, because you're above that. People are very immature in attacking people these days. And how many of you know, don't be the same as them. Don't let them pull you down to their level. You say, I'm going to be above this in the name of Jesus. I don't care what you just told me, brother, sister. I forgive you in the name of Jesus, and I'm going to move on and glorify my Lord. I'm not going to let nothing hold me back in the name of Jesus. Amen. Each one of us must take an honest self-evaluation of what? Of the gifts God has placed on our lives in real time right now. When you are using your God-given talent, God-given gifts and talents to glorify God and advance His kingdom, you will feel happy and blessed and be very content, because you will be doing God's purpose to advance His kingdom in serving others. Isn't it a great feeling that you, when you share the word of God with somebody and they accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, God used you in order for them to have eternal salvation, to be with the Lord. Isn't it a great feeling when you reach out to somebody and you're praying for them, amen, and trying to encourage them, amen? It's a great feeling when we're used of the Lord. Now, the Bible teaches that we must be good stewards. Somebody say stewards. Webster's Dictionary defines this word stewardship as the careful and responsible management of something entrusted to one's care. That is it's the careful and responsible management of something entrusted to one's care. So how many of you know that we are entrusted to the care of the kingdom of God? We have to understand, you know, many times we think, well, angels will do my work. I don't have to do anything for God. Angels will do it. No, they will not do it. The Bible says Jesus is the head and we are the body. We're the hands and feet of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He gives the orders, we carry them out. He's the boss, we're His servants. He's the boss, and we serve other people. Amen? Because all of us in the body of Christ, truly, we are servants of the Most High God. If you have an ability to fix things, why don't you fix things for the kingdom of God, to bless somebody? If you have the ability to go ahead and to be an encourager and exhorter, exhort people. If you have the ability to go, whatever it might be, there's a million different things you can do. Let's say you're a plumber. How about this? If any churches need plumbing, you go ahead in the house of God and don't charge the church and take care of their plumbing for free. God will bless you with more customers than you even know what to do with. You won't even have, I mean, you're going to have so many customers, you'll have to hire people. When you put God, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all this stuff will be added unto you. So your ability as an electrician, you work in churches and do electrical work for free. Then God will send customers to you by all over the place. How many know when you put God first, God's going to put your stuff first? Amen. Praise God. You know, that's the whole thing. That's the whole key. I mean, we have to know and understand God has given us these abilities, and it's really important that we use them for the kingdom of God. So to take a further look in the Bible, the Greek word for steward actually means one who has the authority and responsibility for, administer, and as a manager. How many know, church, we have responsibility? We have to not sit on our talents. We've got to use them to advance the kingdom of God. Amen. We must remember that the gifts of God on our lives are not for us. They are for others to benefit through us. Amen. In other words, we're serving other people. Amen. In other words, we serve them. The benefits are not for us. It's not like, okay, God made me a plumber so I could do all my plumbing for me and make a bunch of money. God blessed me to be a plumber so I can reach out to other people and to help, especially God and God's people. Amen? So whatever we do, amen, how many of you know you do it for the kingdom of God? The Bible tells us that you and I also have to give an account of our entrusted gifts when we stand before Jesus on Judgment Day. You know, all of us are going to stand before the Lord. And I'll tell you what, let me just say this. If you are a born-again Christian, you got a lot to look forward to. I mean, I can't even tell you, I can only tell you a little bit about, we see through a glass darkly right now. We know the things of God darkly, as 1 Corinthians 13 says. But then we're going to see Jesus face to face. And when that day comes, number one, you're going to have a glorified body. Somebody say, I'm going to have a brand new body. No diabetes, no sickness, no COVID-19, no death, no losses, no bags under the eyes. Amen? No double chins? Somebody look at your neighbor and say, he's not talking about you, so don't worry about it. You know, we're not going to get wrinkled. Miss Maybelline will be out of business because you won't need her anymore. Amen. You're going to have a glorified body. You got that to look forward to. Amen. It's going to be so wonderful. There's not going to be news of death, not going to be news of losses, not going to be news of, you know, you owe all this money to the IRS and all this other stuff. Your problems, your life right now is so temporary compared to an eternity. Don't get too caught up in your problems now. Be heavenly minded. Look to the Lord to take care of your issues. Don't just struggle, looking at your life right now and so forth. The Bible says to focus on the unseen, that is God. It says to focus on Him to get you through your problems. If you fix your mind on heavenly things, the Bible says God will give you peace. He will get you through the situation you're going through now, because this too shall pass. Think about all the other stuff that God has got you through before, right? You thought back then, I don't know how this is going to happen, but God did get you through it. Don't worry about today, live in the present. Don't bring up the past through arguments and so forth. That is in the past. Don't worry about the future, because God says that get on your knees and just pray, and God's got a great future for you, Jeremiah 29:11. So how many of you know that tomorrow will come, and tomorrow's going to go, and then it's going to be Tuesday, and Tuesday's going to come, and Tuesday's going to go, then it's going to be Wednesday, etc., etc., and the Lord will be with you to get you through it. Why waste our time about worrying about things? Let me ask you a question. What one good thing does worry do to a person? Nothing. Makes him miserable. It raises his blood pressure. It causes stress in his life. It causes him to go to the doctor a lot sooner. It causes nervous breakdowns. It causes panic attacks. So why worry when you can pray? Bible says Philippians 4:6 in the Word of God. It says, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. How many know, church, we got to give our worries to the Lord. We got to just give them to Him. Amen. In the name of Jesus, not worry about things. Amen. Trust in the Lord. But let me tell you this little tidbit on the side here. If you're not reading this book every day, and if you're not coming to church on a regular basis, and if you're not a person of prayer, your worrying is going to go way up. Why? You're not focused on the problem solver, the worry solver. It's what you have your mind focused on every day in your habits that's going to give you the victory. Amen. There are so many Christians, it's so disappointing to me, there are so many Christians that are not reading the Bible every day. Start reading it. Start today. A chapter a day helps keep the devil away. Amen? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. If we're focused on God's word every day, we're feeding our spirit man, and what's happening is the negative emotions in our flesh are subsiding because we're trusting in God for our situations. How many know we got to trust in the Lord? Who else are you going to trust in? There's nothing and no one else to trust in. Amen? Praise God. I want to turn over to Matthew 25:14, if I could, for a few moments, amen, in the Word of God. And I just want to talk about something that Jesus talked about in the Word. Matthew 25, starting reading verse 14. This is a story of the three servants. Somebody say servants. Now, we're going to take a look at two of them that were faithful and one of them that was unfaithful. And what happened to the one that was unfaithful? Verse 14. Jesus' words. Again, the kingdom of heaven can be illustrated by the story of a man going on a trip. He called together his servants and gave them money to invest for him while he was gone. Now, let's stop for a minute. Okay, so a man's going on a trip. He doesn't tell his servants. There's three servants he calls into his office. Hey, guys, I'm going on a trip. Servants are like, when are you coming back? I'm not telling you, but I'm coming back. And I got a job for you. I want you to invest the money that I'm going to give you for me. Because when I come back, I want an increase. So let's see what happens. Verse 15. He gave 5 bags of gold to one, 2 bags of gold to another, and 1 bag of gold to the last, dividing it in proportion to their abilities. Let's stop there. God will only give us what you and I can handle. He'll never give us anything over our heads that we can't handle. He gave them these talents according to their abilities. He didn't give the guy with the one talent the 5 because he knew he couldn't handle it. So God will always give us what He knows we can handle. That's why we've got to take a step of faith and have confidence in a good biblical self-esteem, a healthy self-esteem in the things of God, and move forward. Because like Timothy, young Timothy as a minister in the New Testament, Paul's encouraging him saying, Timothy, God has not given you a spirit of fear. That is a spirit of being timid and shy to people. God's called you to get up and share and preach and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Don't worry about what they think. You just present the gospel to them. Amen? Too many times the devil holds us back from doing God's work because he makes us feel like, oh, I can never do that. I can't do anything right. Yes, you can. Amen. You're a child of God. Take a step of faith. Be used of the Lord. Amen? Praise God. I don't know. I feel like somebody, I don't know who it is, and I'm not asking anybody to raise their hand now. God has been moving on your heart for a long time for a particular ministry that he wants to birth in your life. And you've been holding back and resisting. You've been listening to Satan telling you you're not good enough. You didn't go to Bible school. You didn't do this. You didn't do that. You can't do nothing. And he's just holding you back. But I want you to pray to the Lord. I want you to ask God and get on your knees and say, Lord, I know you've been moving on my heart, and I'm going to take a step of faith in the name of Jesus. And as a result of that, God's going to birth a new ministry in your life. Amen. Satan is the one that comes to kill brand new births. Look what he did to Moses. Knowing that Moses was going to be used of the Lord, he moved on evil Pharaoh's heart to go ahead and to tell all the midwives to kill all the baby boys as they were being born, to slaughter them. Moses was spared. Satan tried to move on Jesus himself through Herod to try to kill him. Oh, show me where this wonderful Messiah is so I can go worship him. That's what Herod said. No, Herod was going to kill Jesus. He didn't want another king coming on the scene. Satan was using Herod to try to kill Jesus. So we have to know and understand, Satan will try to destroy something at its birth, but how many know we're overcomers and the Lord will more than conquerors? Amen. And we can take a step of faith in the name of Jesus, amen? So verse 15 says, he gave 5 bags of gold to one, 2 bags of gold to another, and 1 bag of gold to the last, dividing it to the proportion of their abilities, and then left on his trip. The servant who received the 5 bags of gold began immediately, the Bible says. He what? He began immediately to invest the money, and soon he doubled it. So the guy with the 5 believed his master was coming back. He believed that, you know, I've got a job to do. I'm going to immediately start doing this job. And he doubled it. He turned the 5 into 10. And notice the servant, verse 17, the servant with 2 bags of gold also went right to work and doubled the money. He also went right to work. These two guys, the one with the 5 and the one with the 2, they believed the master was coming back and he wanted an increase. They believed he was coming back and they did his work. Let me ask you, church, do you believe Jesus is coming back? Because if you don't, you ain't going to do nothing for him. And I'm not trying to come down hard on anybody today. But if we in our heart don't believe that Jesus is ever going to return in the rapture or return in the second coming, we're going to just sit back and go, oh, yeah, I'm so happy I got these gifts. I'll use them for me. I'm not going to use them for him. Because one day he's coming back and he's going to want an account. We got to give him an account. What did you do? You know, when I stand before the throne of God, you know, I mean, Craig, what did you do for me? Well, you know, Lord, I know you called me to be a pastor, but I just didn't think I could handle it. So I just didn't go forward. Well, Craig, 0 rewards. Do you understand what you could have done if you took a step of faith and did what I called you to do? Did you understand what could have been done in Uganda with literally thousands of people coming to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior? Do you understand that radio program gets out to 5 million people? Do you understand how many people came to the cross, could have come to the cross in even 26 years of you pastoring and teaching? I'll be honest with you, I didn't want to be a pastor. This is my personal testimony. I wanted to work under, I had a great pastor before the Lord was leading on my heart to be a pastor. And I wanted to work under that pastor. I wanted to be, you know, I wanted to be a her and a Moses. And an Aaron holding his arms up. I wanted to be an encourager. I wanted to be, his right-hand man. I wanted to be the guy behind the scenes, not the guy in front of the scenes. In my freshman year, I went to the Vogue. How many of us went to the Vogue? Pat went to the Vogue. Okay, he graduated with me up there. He's a cameraman up there. All right. I took up radio and TV repair. Go figure. Now, the Lord told me, I want you to repair hearts. I said, okay, Lord, you just showed me how to do that. But anyway, I remember in my first year of high school, amen, my freshman year, we had a book report we had to do. I was so shy that on that Monday morning when that book report was supposed to stand in front of the class for 5 minutes and talk about the book that we were reading. I was so shy, I pretended I had the flu to mom and dad, and they didn't send me to school that day. That's how shy I was. I said, Lord, I can't stand in front of people. So the Lord kept on through a series of circumstances, take too long to get into the specifics, but through a series of circumstances, God was moving on my heart and so forth. And what happened was, finally, I told him, I said, Lord, I can't do this. He said, that's the right answer. So what do you mean that's the right answer? He said, you step out in faith, open your mouth, and I'm going to fill it. You just be obedient to me as a vessel, and I'm going to do all the work. You ain't going to get no glory, and I don't want no glory. I want him to get all the praise, honor, and the glory. Amen? And that's how he led upon my heart. I remember the first pulpit I had, amen, was in a little tiny corner store with probably five people. And my first pulpit was a hassock. You know, the kind of thing you put your feet on? Because there's no pulpits like this in a building like this. But just preaching the word of God and teaching the word of God. And God showed me some things and so forth. So when I get behind this pulpit, I say, okay, Lord, take over. We're the vessel, man. The vessel doesn't get the glory ever. It never should. Only the Lord should get the glory. I had one person one time, they said, Pastor Craig, I hurt my ankle really bad. He came up to the altar for prayer. I anointed him with oil as the Bible instructs us to. Amen. And I prayed that the Lord would heal him. And he came in church the following week. He says, as soon as Pastor prayed for me, I was totally healed. I walked out of the church with absolutely no pain. He says, oh, thank you for healing me, Pastor Craig. I said, time out. I said, the Lord healed you, not Pastor Craig. I was the vessel he used, but the Lord actually healed you. When I go out to get some Dunkin' Donuts coffee and I go up to the drive-up window, I don't say, give me a medium styrofoam cup, please. I say, give me a medium cup of coffee. But the vessel, the cup comes with the coffee because it delivers it. The main thing is I'm going for the coffee. I'm not going for a free cup. Somebody say that's a weird analogy, but I get it. Next time you get a cup of coffee, you go to Dunkin' Donuts, you're going to think of that, aren't you? See that? Mm-hmm. Somebody say, praise God. The Bible says in our earthen bodies, we have treasure. The treasure is the Holy Spirit of God who lives within us. That's why no man should ever be elevated or praised. We see that Paul, and I think it was Apollos one time, and people started to worship them because of the healings, and they rebuked them and said, don't you dare worship us. You worship God and him only. Amen? There was another man in the Bible, Herod, who was worshipped by everybody. He's a god, he's not a man. He's a god, he's not a man. And immediately God struck him dead because he was accepting people's worship. See, that's what we're studying in the book of Acts. That's all the stuff you're missing. Amen. All right, let's get back to the word. All right, so verse 17 says, the servant with two bags of gold also went right to work and doubled the money. But the servant who received the one bag of gold dug a hole in the ground and hid the master's money for safekeeping. Look, the third guy did. Well, you know, I know I have the, you know, I know he wants an increase, but I'll just bury it in the ground. So after a long time, their master returned from his trip and called them to give an account for how they had used his money. So notice the master came back. Somebody say he came back. It was a long time, but he came back. Today, some people are even saying, where is the promise of Jesus' coming? For 2,000 years, they've been saying the rapture's going to come. That ain't never going to happen. Do you know that's actually prophesied in the book of 1 Peter, that people are going to say that? They're saying that today. But as Noah happened, amen, and as the flood came, and Noah told them for 120 years and preached it, it did come, and all the people were wiped out. The rapture of the church will surely happen. Every single scripture, every prophecy in the Bible is going to happen. Amen? Our disbelief is not going to prevent it not to happen. Amen? So after a long time, their master returned, verse 19, from his trip and called them to give an account for how they had used the money. The servant to whom he had entrusted the five bags of gold said, sir, you gave me five bags of gold to invest, and I have doubled the amount. Here's 10. The master was full of praise. Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together, verse 22. Next came the servant who had received the two bags of gold with the report, sir, you gave me two bags of gold to invest, and I have doubled the amount. The master said, well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together. Then the servant with the one bag of gold, I could see him coming with his little one bag of gold, all dirty, you know, getting the dirt off of it because he had it buried for so long when his master was gone for a long time. His head's probably down like this, you know, and anyway, he comes up to him. The servant with the one bag of gold came and said, sir, I know you are a hard man, and harvesting crops you didn't plant and gathering crops you didn't cultivate. I was afraid I would lose your money, so I hid it in the earth, and here it is. How many know there's always an excuse for something? I was afraid I'd lose it. I'm a great guy. I hid it. But yet he gave him specific instructions. I want an investment on what I'm giving you when I come back. He couldn't go with that excuse. But the master replied, verse 26, you wicked and lazy servant, you think I'm a hard man, do you? Harvesting crops I didn't plant and gathering crops I didn't cultivate? Well, you should at least have put the money into the bank so I could have some interest. Why do you think he didn't put it in the bank? There'd be a record of it. This boy wanted to steal the money when his master didn't come back because he didn't believe he was. Take the money from the servant and give it to the one with the 10 bags of gold. To those who use well what they are given, even more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who are unfaithful, even what little they have will be taken away. Now throw this useless servant into outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. I don't know about you, church, but I want to make sure I use my talents and abilities for the Lord. How about you? Amen. And I'm telling you something, don't get on this, the low self-esteem, I can't do anything. Yes, you can. You're a child of God. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Amen? God loves you. Somebody say, God loves me. Amen. Luke chapter 18, verse 29 and 30, the Bible says, yes, Jesus replied, and I assure you that everyone who has given up house or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God will be repaid many times over in this life and will have eternal life in the world to come. Jesus promises it. 1 Peter 4, 10 and 11, it goes on to say, God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to serve. Why? To serve one another. How many know we got to serve one another? Amen? Do you have the gift of speaking? Then speak as though God himself was speaking through you. Do you have the gift of helping others? Do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies. Then everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. All glory and power to him forever and ever. Amen. So how many know, church, we got to serve others with the motive of love? Not with the motive of to get. I know one time a Christian said, I don't care about my rewards, bless God, I just want to go ahead and get to heaven. I said, well, these are eternal rewards. And it's not a greed thing that, okay, God, I'm going to do a lot for you so I can get a lot. No, it's, Lord, I'm going to do what you called me to do. Because truly, all the gifts go back to him. He's the one who initiated giving us the gifts. So all the, if you want to use the term profit, or all the multiplication goes back to the Lord in his, for his glory and praise. Amen? So we must serve with the motive of love. So, you know, we've got to fear God in this process as well. We talked about the fear of God several times. I even did series on the fear of God. And I want to just end with two scriptures. Then I want to ask you some questions to try to help you out to cultivate and see what giftings you have. Now, I know a lot of you already have giftings that you're doing. And God bless you. Praise God for that. Keep it up. Keep up the great good work. But how many of you know you could even do more for the Lord? Amen. Galatians chapter 6, verses 4 and 5 in the Message version, it says, make a careful exploration of you who are the work, make a careful exploration of who you are and the work you have been given, and then sink yourself into that. How many know when you do something, you do it with all your might in the kingdom of God? You do the best job you can possibly do. Don't be impressed with yourself. Don't compare yourself with others. Each of you must take responsibility for doing the creative best you can with your own life. Amen? You know, I'm right now, as some of you know, I'm writing another book, my second book. It's a 365-day devotional, and I'm not rushing it. Some people have asked me, when's it going to be done? I said, I don't know. But when every time I sit at my desk and every time I look at that, I pray. I said, Lord, what do you want me to have in this next daily devotional? And the Lord moves on my heart. And I don't want to do a shoddy job just to pump it out in 2 weeks or 3 weeks. If it takes me 6 months, I want to put something out there that's going to be a blessing for the kingdom of God. I want to do the best that I can do with what the Lord has given me. It's not, by the way, just a devotional, a feel-good devotional. It's a devotional slash Bible study. It's not going to be sugar-coated. We're going to talk about what is hell and how to avoid it. We're going to talk about what is sin, how to repent. But it's not all bad. It talks about how to have the joy of the Lord, which is our strength. Amen. It talks about the difference between happiness and joy. It talks about a lot of different things. It talks about how to be kind. Somebody say kind. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, I'm so happy that you're a kind person. Somebody's thinking, yeah, I know, I walked in a post office yesterday and I was in a rush and man, I slammed that door in that lady's face and that wasn't too kind. Somebody say, we have to have patience. Ask God for patience. Amen. So at this point in the message, I want to ask you some questions. Amen. How to discover your God-given gifts and talents. Number one is this. What are you naturally good at? You know, a lot of us are naturally good at certain things. I know you can say, what am I naturally good at? How, you know, I'm good at this, I'm good at that. Okay, how can I use that to advance the kingdom of God? What am I good at? Secondly, what energizes you? What makes you pumped up? You know, what makes you excited? You know what I mean? Like, you know, today's the Super Bowl, right? Tonight at 6:30 it begins. Some people, you know, they want the Eagles to win. Others want the Chiefs to win. But when you're watching the game, does that pump you up? Say, how in the world can that be used to advance the kingdom of God, Pastor Craig? Well, why not invite some of your unsaved loved ones over to see the game with you? Give them some nice food and hors d'oeuvres and serve it to them. And then share the word with them during halftime. Somebody say, praise the Lord. You can use anything to advance the kingdom of God. Amen? What are you drawn to? What grabs your interest? Amen? What grabs your interest? You know, one time I was watching a program on one of the television programs and so forth. And for whatever reason, it really grabbed my interest. It was called Deadliest Catch. How many of us have heard or seen Deadliest Catch? You say, how in the world did that grab your interest? I don't know, man. I was just asking myself 1,000 questions. These captains and the crews go on out on these boats, and they're literally taking their life in their own hands. And I know and understand that they're gonna get cut a check for 20 grand for doing about 10 days work. I get it. But is that really worth putting your life out there for? I don't know. Maybe it is. But whatever the case is, amen. How many know that there are certain things that grab your interest? You know, I was watching Facebook the other day, and Brother Joe, you know, Hamboro, who preaches, every single year, revival here. Well, he does a Friday night Bible study, and they were putting it on Facebook. I saw that, and that grabbed my interest. I texted him, and I PM'd him later on. I said, Joe, I so wish I could go to your Bible studies. I would love to sit there and participate in that. That just grabbed my interest. He lives in Connecticut, by the way, so I didn't want to drive 2 hours either way for a Bible study. But anyway, the things of God, does that grab your interest? Are you genuine interested when somebody talks about the Bible? When somebody talks about the things of God, does that make you like pumped up? Yeah, let's talk about this, amen? So what grabs your interest in life? What would you be drawn to? Let's say, for example, somebody said that you could do anything you want in life and not get paid for it. In other words, somebody says, I'm going to take care of all your expenses. What do you want to do in life? What would it be? Amen? You know, you think about that. Amen? And who are you drawn to? Who are you drawn to? Amen? Are you drawn to ministers or other Christian people, people that loved God and the things of God and so forth? How many of you know we got to ask ourselves all these questions? And by the way, if you want to get really... if you want to try to take, I have a, upstairs in my office, I have a very long exam of spiritual gifts. And if you all want me to go ahead and email that to you, by all means, I can do that. At the end of that, at the end of answering a lot of questions, it tells you what your spiritual gifts are in the Lord. It's just that using those for the kingdom of God. But how many know, church, how many know we got a job to do? There are so few Christians doing what God wants them to do. So many Christians have the mentality, I know, but somebody else will do it. The grass needs to be cut, I know, Pastor Craig, but somebody else will do it. I know that this thing has to be done, but somebody else will do it. How many know Mr. Else is extremely busy? Amen? The somebody else is you. I'll do it. I'll do it, Lord. Amen. If we understood the rewards that we're going to get for an eternity, whenever I said, I need somebody to cut the grass, we'd have a ton of line of people saying, fighting. I want to do it. No, I want to do it. No, I want to do it. Where can I start? Because it's God's house. You understand what I mean? Look at the unseen. Look at the future. None of us are going to be here 100 years from today. Amen? And how many of you know right now is the time? Redeeming the time, the Bible says. Now's the time that we need to be used of the Lord. Don't get sidetracked with this temporary life. But how many of you know, church, be encouraged because you can be a wonderful person to advance the kingdom of God in what you're doing and also what you can be doing. Amen? Somebody say praise God. Let's stand on our feet. Father, we thank you for your message today, Lord God, and we magnify your mighty name. I pray, Lord, that you move on our hearts, dear Holy Spirit. The things that we are doing for you to advance your kingdom, let us do them with excellence. Let us do the very best job we possibly could do under the anointing of your Spirit. I pray, Lord, that you'd birth new ministries, that, Lord, we can go ahead, Lord God, and be used of you like never before. The ministries we're talking about today can happen here in this local church, but they can also happen outside the local church. They could be even in our business place or other places, Lord. We could be ministering. There's so many people that need to know Jesus, Lord. We need to get beyond these four walls and be a servants of you like never before. Father, we thank you for that. We praise your mighty name, and we ask these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Hi, everybody. My name is Pastor Craig Matheson. I'm the pastor of Changing Lives Christian Church here in Haverhill, Massachusetts. And I just want to do this short video concerning basically what we do here in the ministry, what our outreach ministries are, and basically how our services are conducted, our Bible studies, and all kinds of wonderful things that are going on. I know some of you have written in and asked me, you know, what is the format of your service? How long is your service? What are the ministries do you have in the church? You know, and all these different things I just want to talk about today. But I want to open up with the word of scripture, which is found in the book of Matthew, chapter 28, in verses 18 through 20. Jesus told us, and this is referred to as the Great Commission. He says, Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given complete authority in heaven and in earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. He says to teach these new disciples to obey all commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Now, the heartbeat of Changing Lives Christian Church is to get the good news out, to evangelize, to get the gospel out, to share this wonderful gospel message with the entire world. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And so we want to make that invitation known as God's servants, as his messengers, as his church. We want to go ahead and share this word with the entire world. And I just want to let you know what we're doing here in the ministry of Changing Lives Christian Church so you have a good basis. Some of you watch us, I'm sure, on community television every week. Some of you are watching our YouTube videos as well. So we just want to kind of, you know, give you a heads up and explain what our church ministry is about. The first thing is this, that we are a born-again evangelical Christian church. So evangelical means we evangelize, we try to get the word of God out in all different ways. You know, basically we're born again. Jesus says you must be born again, you know, and so forth. We're born again Christians. Our Sunday worship service is at 11 o'clock every Sunday morning. And if you want to get here early, you can. We're the church is open as early as 10 o'clock in the morning. We have some coffee and pastries before the service begins. We have a small team of people that are praying around 10:45 in the church right now to prepare for the service and all. If you want to participate in that, if not, that's okay as well. Our service starts promptly at 11 o'clock. Now, basically, we open up in a word of prayer. Then after we pray, we go ahead and we do four YouTube worship songs. We have two big screens in the front of the church. And when the YouTube songs are playing, you can sing along because all the lyrics are right up there on those screens. Now we're blessed because every other week we have a live worship team of five men that come in and bless us, you know, singing four different songs, contemporary Christian music, and, you know, it's kind of upbeat, which is great. We get into the praise and worship and just to magnify the Lord. After the song service is done in our service, what we do is this. I take up the offering, make a few announcements, then I get right into the Word of God. The total amount of time from beginning to end is about 1 hour. Probably from 11 to 12 o'clock if you want to, you know, If you're thinking, how long is your service? Because I know different churches have different, different lengths of time as far as the service goes. Now, we also live stream all of our church services on Sunday morning. We have two Facebook platforms, Changing Lives Christian Church Facebook platform, and also my own personal Craig S. Matheson Facebook platform as well. So we live stream to those two platforms in Facebook, and we have a YouTube channel. Changing Lives Christian Church has a YouTube channel, and so on a typical Sunday morning, if you are a subscriber to our YouTube channel, you're automatically going to see our services. If you are on our Facebook page or with one of our friends and so forth, then you'll see that automatically as well. So that's kind of neat that we can do that. Now, we're literally live streaming to Africa, to the UK, to Kenya, to Uganda, to many, many, many parts of the world. And many people write in and they tell us, I'm watching from Uganda, I'm watching from Africa, I'm watching from the UK, etc. So it's really awesome that we can do that. You know, we're not a lot of people in our church. We may be about 40 people in all, maybe 50 on a good Sunday morning. However, we're getting the gospel out beyond these four walls in the church, and that's what really, really counts. And so besides that, believe it or not, we're on 11 different community television stations right now. So every week, our services are shown on 11 different community television stations covering the entire Merrimack Valley. So it's really neat. You know, we're on all different different towns and so forth. So hopefully you can turn it on community television as well and see us preaching there. The last Sunday of every month, right after the worship service is concluded, we have a wonderful fellowship hall here at the church. And what we do is we ask people to bring a covered dish, and we go ahead and we get together and we have a nice fellowship dinner together at the church. So it's really, really neat to get to know each other much better. The other thing, too, I want to mention is we have our Bible study midweek. Every Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, we have an open discussion Bible study. There's a small group of us that meet upstairs here in my office. And basically what we do is right now, in fact, we're going through the book of Psalms, verse by verse. And so if you want to participate in that, feel free to. It's open discussion. You have any questions about the Bible, that's fine. If you need a Bible, come to our Bible study. We'll give you a free Bible. You know, we want to really, really help you in your relationship with God. Amen. And also, we have a love outreach ministry, which started just about maybe 7 months ago. It's awesome. We have free movie nights every single month here at the church. They're usually on Saturday nights and so forth. And basically, they're free. Anybody can come in. We get some nice gourmet popcorn. We get coffee. We get tea. We even have a raffle with some gift baskets that are donated to us that the members here at the church make. And we have a wonderful raffle as well. It's a lot of fun. You know, it's good Christian fun. Evangelical movie. We give away free literature, free books, and things like that on that movie night. And it's a love outreach. It's in order to not just invite our church members here, but to invite everybody, even people that aren't part of our church, to the church. So that's really, really important. We also do cookouts in the summertime with the Love Outreach Ministry. You know, we set up a bunch of tables in the front of our church building, and we invite the neighbors, we invite the homeless, we invite anybody at all who wants to have a bite to eat with us and to share the gospel with them as we're sharing the food and so forth. So that's really great, and it works out really well. Once a month, it's so awesome. The first Saturday of every month, I have the privilege of doing a radio program all the way in Uganda. That's right, I said Uganda. It's called Grace Radio 92.6 FM in Uganda. What happens is I sit at my desk in my office, I prepare a teaching ahead of time, and I'm on Zoom. And there's another individual that is interpreting for me right at the radio station of everything I'm saying. And the first half hour is the teaching. The next half hour is people calling in, and they have prayer requests. We pray for them. You should see the testimonies going on there. People are getting saved. People are being delivered from witchcraft. People are getting born again. People are, you know, it's just awesome what's going on. And we thank God for that ministry that we are a part of. We have another ministry here at the church called Healing Heart Ministry. Now, the Healing Heart Ministry is giving to orphans and widows, giving money to orphans and widows. And that is through the Samaritan's Purse Ministry and also through Covenant House Ministries. So that's really a blessing. Besides that healing, besides those two ministries giving to them to help those individuals, we also are taking up offerings. We're taking up money in order to give to the poor children in Uganda. These poor kids live on the street. They don't even have a home to go to. And so we feel really bad. We have people up there that we know, the same individual that interprets for us in the radio program. She's a wonderful woman of God, and she goes ahead and takes this money, makes as much food as possible with the money, and has a bunch of children show up, sometimes 100, 200 kids, whatever amount of food they have that they can give them a really hearty, good meal. So we really have a heart for kids. We want to go out and reach out to them as well through that Healing Heart Ministry. We also have a food pantry here. You know, if you need free groceries, feel free to come. Every Sunday morning from 9:30 to 10:30 in the morning, we have a free food food pantry. So come on and pick up some free groceries if you'd like. Nothing to be embarrassed about if you're running a little low. I know the cost of living is very high right now and so forth. So we want to reach out to people with our church and give them some free groceries as well. I also have a counseling ministry here. I counsel people, of course, in the church as well as outside the church as well, called Christian Counseling in Haverhill. And so that really works out great. So I just want to encourage you, just get a little more information about our church. I want to keep on airing this for a while on community TV, just so you have a good idea of what Changing Lives Christian Church is about. Maybe many of you watch the program every week, but you're not quite sure what goes on in the background and what we do. So we're doing all these things in the name of the Lord, and we're really blessed to do these things. I just want to encourage you to like us on Facebook, Changing Lives Christian Church on Facebook. Just hit the like, and also subscribe, and also push the notification bell on our YouTube channel. And every single time that we post a new video, you're going to be notified that new video is on there, and you can watch it. So I hope to see you this coming Sunday at 11 o'clock. Hope to meet you, and may God bless you, and have a fantastic day. Hi, I'm Pastor Craig Matheson. I just want to encourage you to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Now, those of you watching by YouTube right now, all you have to do is on the right bottom side of your screen, you'll see a little red subscribe button. Click on that subscribe button, then you're going to see a notification bell come up. Click on the notification bell. From that point on, every service and every video that we have is going to be, you'll be notified in order to see it. Now, those of you watching by community television, you can also subscribe to our YouTube channel. All you need to do is log on to youtube.com, then in the search engine, type in Changing Lives Christian Church, and then our YouTube channel is going to come up. Then just hit the subscribe key and the notification bell after that, and then You will also be notified every time we have a church service or a special video. So I just want to encourage you to go ahead and to do that. And I hope you have a fantastic day today, and may God bless you.